Good morning, people of God. Whew, what an extra little journey we had this morning to get to worship this morning, but I pray this finds you well today. I begin this morning with a heart that's been heavy for some time now, especially since this past Wednesday, where some people stormed our nation's capital. As I stand before you today, I want it known that I very intentionally refrained from speaking publicly or writing across media about my stance on politics. I know that some of you, maybe many of you, have made assumptions on, based on my sermons, perhaps on my prayers. I've refrained from taking a stance as a pastor of our family of faith because I know we are a people, a lot like our society, who are politically divided. And I didn't want to take a risk alienating any of you who I have come to care for and love. I can't even begin to guess how many of us have unfriended loved ones and family members over politics these past 4 years. I understand all too well how exhausting it is to try to speak to someone, let alone have a relationship with someone who sees something important so fundamentally different. And here's where I struggle, because it is so much easier to walk away from them and to cut them out of our lives. But in doing so, it just leads to dismissing others easier and easier the more we do it, which leads to the ease of which we strike one another down in word and deed, which leads to the violence and destruction because a relationship no longer matters. I wonder if we're more divided because of our differing viewpoints or because we'd rather choose to give up on things that are broken. Again, what I share this morning is what's been put on my heart. It's my truth. It may not be yours, but I pray that we can still have a relationship together. With all that said, what happened this past week is unacceptable and wrong. I need that named. From the individuals who stormed the Capitol to the leadership who suggested that it should happen, there is nothing of what it means to be a person of faith that can justify the behavior of a mob. Nothing. There is nothing of what it means to be a true follower of Jesus that justifies anyone acting in any way that threatens the life of someone else. Nothing. I shudder to think what would have happened if those people would have been people of color. Because I saw a very different response to the vandalism and disrespect that was shown on Wednesday compared to some of the peaceful protests that happened in that same very city this past summer. And so we're clear, I'm against all riots and all threat of life. For Christians, our baseline for living is found in how God showed up in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, who instead of choosing judgment, chose to show love. I continue to pray so much. I was on my knees just a moment ago. For discernment in all of this, for myself, for all of you, for our entire nation. In the meantime, I lean on these things. Every single one of us bears the image of God. And because of that reason, we are deserving of love and respect. In our baptisms, we are called to forgive one another and to strive for reconciliation always, even if a relationship seems without hope. So I pray that we have the ability, that God gives us the Spirit to have the ability to make space to hear one another, to know and to care for one another, as Jesus has done for each and every one of us. I didn't want to send a letter out this week. I didn't want it to be possibly read. I needed that to be said and spoken out loud. As for announcements this morning, we'll once again be having communion, so please have that ready following our confession this morning. Other than that, be sure to check out the Constant Contact that we send out every Wednesday, and that'll have other announcements in it. But let's get after it. So I invite you to stand if you're able, if you so desire. Otherwise, be comfortable, and let us join our voices in our opening song of praise. Chat feature is not available this morning. We had to rush to quick get a new link together, so our apologies for that. And then secondly, I wanted to just note that I think we unintentionally decided it's going to be Christmas for the rest of 2021, and we're just going to leave these decorations up. Yes, you all good? We're going to add more and more Christmas decorations. Yes.
Birthday was February 23rd, and we used to leave the stuff up until his birthday. So yes. I'm thinking that's a goal.
That okay, in honor of Mark's father, we are leaving, and we've got to beat that. So
who was, by the way, a lifetime Christian Lutheran organist. So he
done. So. Okay, at least until February 23rd, done. let us pray. Holy God, creator of light and giver of goodness, your voice moves over the waters. Immerse us in your grace and transform us by your Spirit, that we may follow after your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And all of God's people say, Amen. Well, dear children of God, grace to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to jump right into our gospel reading for today. It comes to us from the book of Mark, the first chapter. For the record, we will be in the book of Mark all through the season of Epiphany and even moving into Lent. So we're going to tackle Mark for quite some time. There's one reading of John I think we get either next week or the next. But after that, we get a lot of Mark. Well, today is known as Baptism of Our Lord Sunday. And this is Mark's version of the baptism of our Lord. It starts in verse 4. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I've baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of that water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you, I am well pleased." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So one of the curses of being a pastor is that from time to time, well, maybe more than just time to time, I find myself wondering whether my preaching really makes a difference. Now, that's not to say I doubt that it should make a difference. We're talking about the gospel of Jesus Christ here. However, whether or not it actually does make a difference. And on a Sunday like today, Baptism of Our Lord Sunday, I'm definitely wondering that question a ton. Because what we're talking about here is a big deal. The baptism of our Lord. And I can't help but wonder, how many people understand why it's a big deal? Why Jesus' baptism matters? Or even why Jesus was baptized in the first place? Or how our baptism is connected to Jesus? Or why our baptisms even matter? And I know all this is intensified knowing that we have a ton on our hearts to wonder and worry about these days. Our economy, a deeply divided government, an increasing polarized culture, wars and rumors of wars, not to mention that we're still stuck in the muck of a pandemic. And that's just on the global front. At home, we're preoccupied with concerns for our kids, whether it be with school or how they're handling things lately. We're concerned about jobs, maybe getting back to college or to seminary, or losing a loved one, or helping a parent struggling with health issues, or a sibling struggling with addiction, the prospect of finding a life partner, and so much more. All to say that there are probably a lot of things that we feel that are way more pressing than commemorating the baptism of our Lord, let alone remembering our own. But stick with me for a moment, and let's just see. Let's see what baptism could mean, why it could matter for us today. So let's kick this off with some of the very questions that plague us. Well, they plague me. they might plague you about our story from the book of Mark today. First off, why was Jesus baptized? Well, it turns out we're not the first ones to ask that question. In fact, it was one of the earliest and rather thorny questions the first Christians had to deal with. Because you see, back then, at Jesus' time, even Mark mentions, people were being baptized for the repentance and forgiveness of their sins. They were baptized, confessing their sins, coming up out of the water, being forgiven of their sins. And here we have Jesus Christ, who is the sinless Son of God, who knew no sin. Which begs that question, why on earth would Jesus need to be baptized then? And further, what does it make of John that Jesus would have to come to him? He couldn't baptize himself. No. Well, that last question is easier to figure out. In multiple accounts, Matthew, Luke, and what we hear in Mark today, clears up that question about John really quickly, where even John admits, hey, I'm not even worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. Okay, so that clears that up very quickly. John may baptize Jesus, but Jesus is the greater. And John's the first one to point out that he's just the way that God is getting to him. That's it. But that first question, why was Jesus baptized? Well, it's a bit trickier. It turns out none of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, answer that question for us. In fact, when we look again at what Mark tells us about Jesus' baptism, what's most striking is that Jesus doesn't really do or say anything that sheds light on why he would need to be baptized. In fact, he's passive altogether. As Mark tells us, in those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John of the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove, and a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." So for Mark, there wasn't even the dunking or the pouring of water. It was just like, well, after the baptism happened, he skipped right past it. Jesus is totally passive throughout the whole thing. Everything just happens to him. And on second thought, maybe that's the way it should be. I mean, after all, this is the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, the start of his long and difficult journey that will eventually lead to his death on a cross. And so at his baptism, Jesus doesn't have to do anything but simply receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and of God's favor. And what an amazing gift it is. A powerful word of acceptance, identity, blessing, and commitment. All in that phrase, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." I can only imagine how Jesus might have longed to hear such words like that, and how much strength that would have given him throughout his ministry to come even to hang on that cross, when obviously he had the power to get down off of that cross. No, Jesus doesn't need forgiveness, but I have to believe he needed that reminder to know who and whose he was, to hear that he's accepted, loved, and pleasing to God. These were powerful words that shaped not only that day, but probably and very likely and for sure the rest of his life. Which brings us to you and to your baptisms. And a reminder of why Jesus' baptism matters so much. Because each of us so long to hear words of acceptance, identity, blessing, and commitment, don't we? Which is precisely the gift of baptism. One of the many amazing things you're going to find in the Bible is the promise that we have been united with Christ in a baptism like his. And like Jesus in our reading today, you don't have to do anything to receive the amazing gifts given to you in your baptisms. In fact, it's actually the reason as Lutherans we do infant baptisms, because there is absolutely nothing a baby can do to receive God's love. It is not about that baby or about you as an adult accepting Jesus into your life. Baptism is a promise that God accepts you into his. Baptism is the promise that you are a part of something so much bigger than yourself. Not because of who you are or what you will do, but because God is a loving parent who wants nothing but the best for his beloved creation. And I'm not even going to ask for an amen. I'm just going to shout an amen for you. Amen. In baptism, God chooses you. In baptism, God says, you are already enough just as you are right now. that you are pleasing to him, and because of that, you deserve to be loved. And that identity of being God's beloved child, precisely because it's established by God and not by what you do, it can never be taken away from you. And here's the deal, you can't lose it. You're stuck with it, whether you like it or not. Instead, God continues to come into your lives. And that's the beauty again of baptism. Yes, it happens once, maybe as a child, maybe as an adult, but it happens every day at the same time. It's such a beautiful thing. And because it happens every day, God continues to come into your lives and to call you beloved, to call you blessed, and to promise once again to always be with and for you. And it's that promise and that identity that in turn helps us to face all those challenges that I mentioned at the beginning of this sermon, along with all the ones that I couldn't even come up with. Whether problems at home or in the community, concerns about the world or your personal lives, you can face whatever might be plaguing you with greater confidence because you have God in your corner. Because today and every day, God says to you, you are my beloved. I mean, just think with me for a moment. Let's take a deep breath here. It's a lot coming out here. But just think what will happen this coming year. All of our hopes and expectations, the decisions that will be made, the relationships that will be started or maybe ended, the career changes, the schools entered, illnesses endured, challenges surmounted, risks taken, adventures dared, love shared. So much life will be coming at us in these coming weeks and months, which can certainly feel daunting, right? Until you remember that God is with you throughout it all. That God is by your side, walking alongside you, strengthening you, encouraging you, granting you enough grace to become the person God desires you to be. I need your attention. Okay, I need you to hear this. This very moment, lean in a little bit more. I'm gonna come up here maybe so you can hear this just a little bit better. Okay? Hear the voice of God today. You. Yeah, you. You. Sitting on that couch or the recliner or on the floor or wherever you're standing, right? You. No, not you. Yes, you. You. Yes. You are a child of God. You are beloved. And God is pleased with you. Do you hear those words? Powerful words given to you today. Words that can and completely will shape your life today and in all the days to come throughout this new year. Words that matter way, way more than we'll ever realize. These words are given to you today. May you hear them. May you believe them. And thank you in advance for sharing them. Amen. Once again, we join. I'll back up and give you some space again. Sorry. once again, we join our voices with our song of praise.
Tried in vain, show the image of your grace. But we are, by your design, signature of the divine. We'll always pray your name, forever and today. Great is your glory, you go before me, and we say, holy, holy, we've seen, and we are by your reprieve. Beauty famed by your suffering, we'll always sing your name forever and today.
Let us pray. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. At the end of each prayer, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond with, hear our prayer. Let us pray. For the church throughout the world and its leaders, that guided by the Holy Spirit, they proclaim the forgiveness of sins. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For wilderness and water, wind and wild beasts, and all living things on earth, that God's goodness is revealed through creation, and that we find ways to care for all God has made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the nations of the world and their leaders, for laborers busy both day and night, for peacemakers amid strife, that God inspire all people to use their strength wisely. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For the sick and those who provide medical care, for the imprisoned and those who show them mercy, for the lonely and those who provide companionship, for all who suffer, that God shower compassion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our family of faith virtually gathered here, for students returning to school, for those seeking renewal in their daily work, that all the beloved of God experience grace and peace today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, and all of God's people say, Amen. We'll now take a moment to reflect on our week and confess those times when we have failed to live as God so desires for us to live. Please repeat after me. Loving God, we confess. We do not trust your abundance. And we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your Spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. And now hear this, dear children of God, beloved children of God. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given over to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by God's authority, I therefore declare unto you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all of God's people say, Amen. This time I invite you to take out your bread and your juice or your wine as we prepare our hearts to receive Jesus Christ. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body, and it's given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, and it's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. At this time, I invite you to take the hands of those who are in your family with you, or extend your hands to join with us across the internet as we pray the prayer our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as you either hand out or commune yourself with the body of Christ, I invite you to take that bread and share these words. The body of Christ given for you. And now, as you either hand out or commune yourself with the juice or wine, I invite you to use these words, the blood of Christ shed for you. People of God, may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in God's grace, and all of God's people say, Amen. And finally, a special thank you for those of you who take the extra time to share God's blessings with us, either through mailing in checks or donating through the website. I was inspired this morning by our 5-year-old, August, who decided he wanted to give his money away to help people. So he gave me $11. I know, it's pretty awesome. Well, Augie, your generosity makes me want to give even more than what our family normally does. So I'm going to add to that $11. I hope you're watching right now. I'm just going to empty my wallet for you and add that to your envelope this morning in hopes that it can change someone's life for the better and make a difference for Jesus Christ. So thank you for your generosity, buddy. And thank you for all of your generosities as well, people of God. Together, we can truly make a difference in this world. I mean, God is good all the time. With all that said, we join our voices in our final song of praise.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King, His love endures forever. Love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Mighty hand in outstretched arms, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Setting sun, His love endures forever. By the grace of God we'll carry on, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful.
A better song could not be sung on the baptism of our Lord Sunday, that through our baptisms, God is with you forever. Amen. Finally, may you receive this blessing.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. And until we meet again, and until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of His hand.
Amen. Go in peace and remember who and whose you are this week. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Found a way to live just like I never could before. I know that I don't have much to give, but I can open any door. Everybody knows the secret. Everybody knows the story. I finally found a way to live in the presence. place to live. It's like I never could before. And I don't have very much to give. Soon I'll open any door. Everybody knows the secret. Everybody knows the score. I have finally found a place to live in the presence of the Lord. Find